So I looked at the back. Audi.
El Café.
Hello and welcome to another poorly recorded redwhiteandblack.com.au podcast with me, Tom Brillier, and I'm with
Richard Lee.
And this is our season 2013 review podcast.
Now for some actual content. End of podcast.
Yeah. Intro music. Yeah. Music just fades right back in.
Let's go home.
Okay. All right, well, good timing for this, I guess, in terms of conversation piece. Because Mark Fine let rip last night on SEN.
Finey,
sorry.
As you'd probably be more likely to know him, man.
Yesterday evening with Finey. Finally went bananas, and
well, that's not unusual, but this time Scott Waters was in the gun.
That's the part that's newsworthy. It's about St Kilda. He's a St Kilda supporter, as he went at lengths to point out at the start.
Yep.
Just so someone thought maybe he was going too hard because he's getting too emotional about it. But basically, he said, well, he did say the club was in disarray, and which probably isn't the kind of word you used to describe St Kilda at the end of the season. It wasn't a great season, but I don't think you'd say it was in disarray. But he said it was in disarray more because he thinks communication lines with Waters and Pelkin, presumably, and other senior staff and maybe the board at the club have broken down.
This is kind of off track a bit, but I was thinking in the last few days, this podcast would have taken probably completely different vibe if the season were 2 or 3 weeks shorter, because we finished the year on our highest winning streak of the year,
two games. We did.
And with the send-offs as well, there was a really good kind of riding off into the sunset kind of feel.
Yep.
Even my dad was saying the last round felt like the glory days, quote-unquote, at Moorabbin. And I was just thinking, if the podcast had come up before those couple of wins, like, this would have been the most dire podcast I can think of. But getting back to Finey, this whole, I can't think of another term now, it's just plastered in my head, but Dwarfgate, these we've got to think of a better term for that. But that, whatever you want to call it, this Finey thing, the rumblings about trades and players getting urged out of end of season trips has kind of flipped all those kind of good vibes kind of on their head.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you say? And
yeah, absolutely.
So when this Finey blast, if you like, came out, I wasn't that surprised because it seems like things had been kind of simmering with the Mad Monday thing and a couple of articles that Caro came up with. One where she was saying the goodwill had gone up in smoke, I think the article title was something like that, and basically just saying that, forecasting what Finey kind of said, just saying that Waters and the football department weren't quite on the same wavelength, more or less, and that, things were a bit awry, not everyone's on the same page as to what is the best path forward in terms of the playing list, in terms of, you know, creating the right culture and whatnot. I didn't agree overall. I don't know what you thought, but I didn't agree overall with the sentiment that Waters should be sacked. But I did agree with his comment about Waters kind of disrespecting or trying to distance himself from everything that's happened in the last decade or so. Would you agree with that?
Agree with what?
You'd agree that he's trying to distance himself from the past and kind of dismissing it, more or less.
Yeah, well, Finey talked about what he said at the Best and Fairest.
Yeah.
And he obviously was then, and we were talking before the podcast, and you mentioned that he said in his... Why don't you mention what he said in the interview on ABC?
I put up the link to Scott having a chat with Libby Gore on the ABC a couple of weeks back, and he talked about amongst a lot of things he said that, alluding to the last decade, the club kind of, I think the quote was something along the lines of, success almost fell in their lap. And I thought, I was really taken aback by that, because I generally think, I'm not sure right now, I can't be definitive as to whether Scott's a really good coach, but I usually like him. But I thought that was a really unlikable thing to say, and I don't think it was the right thing to say, basically, because, I mean, we didn't achieve what we wanted to achieve in the last decade, but at the same time, it was still arguably the club's most successful period. And to just kind of brush it off like that.
But also using the word mediocrity at the BNF.
Yeah.
After a decade, which probably, maybe not so much the GT era, but more so the Ross era, was all about shedding that skin that we'd had for nearly 140 years.
Yeah.
It's not funny. Yeah. Right. Well, did you think? So you said you weren't overly surprised that this idea that Waters and is maybe this idea that Waters is at loggerheads with a few other senior staff around the club.
Okay. Maybe I'm surprised that he's at loggerheads with Palkin. Because Palkin's such a key figure, and the way Scott's been speaking, particularly in the last couple of post-match press conferences and stuff, it seemed like, and in the Libby Gore interview as well, he had a really clear idea of where the club's going next in terms of personnel and what's coming in the next year, 2-3 years. So maybe I was surprised that it was so specific as two guys that are going to have to work so closely together on this kind of stuff. Yeah, maybe I was surprised that they're at loggerheads, but things definitely didn't seem right when you've got Caro shedding light on things here and there. So even the Sam Fisher thing before the year even began, then the Saad selection just after he'd had the positive sample. So there's been just these little spot fires or rumblings, if you like, of things being amiss. So I guess I wasn't surprised in that sense, but I guess at the same time I was taken aback that it was someone as important and as close to Scott as Palkin that he was at loggerheads with, because if that relationship is fractured,
that's not good.
That's big trouble for the club, basically.
Well, it was that the Dustin Martin thing. Might be another
issue. Yeah.
If what the Age reported over the weekend was true, I'm not talking necessarily about Scott Waters saying Fisher and Armitage couldn't go away with Dustin Martin on the end of season trip, but more the fact that, and they used the word warned, that Palkin warned Waters that he couldn't have that kind of control over them. But it did say that they were both in agreement that Waters could urge them to change their plans. I think that was the word they used.
Yeah.
And also, it piqued my interest as well when Finey said, and I'm not a, I've got some inside ties to the club, but I don't know anything about this. When Finey said, there are a few guys at the club going about getting Dustin Martin and doing a good job of it.
Yeah.
But Waters wasn't on the same page. And I thought maybe that might have linked in with the Palkin and Waters disagreement about the in terms of the end of season trip as well. But I mean, to be honest, I had no idea that this might be anything approaching as serious as what Finey said.
Well,
and I'm not saying the sack Waters bit, but I'm talking about how he said Waters' relationship with other people that was beyond disrepair.
Yeah. Well, I guess we should. We should have probably put out a disclaimer before we started this conversation, because Finey is, well, just a warning, if you like, but Finey is, you know, he hosts a night show and he does try and drum up things. So, you know, take Finey's comments don't take them as gospel, basically.
I'm sure everyone knows that.
I hope so. Generally, I like finding he's got a pretty clear view of the game and everything. On this occasion, he might well be jumping the gun. I think with all these little bits and pieces that have bobbed up from Saad to the end of season trip getting cancelled to the Mad Monday thing, I don't think you can argue against things not all being rosy. But whether it's as drastic as what Finey is highlighting, then you know, only time will tell, really.
Well, I mean, that Caro article that you talked about before extends beyond Waters as well. Mm. She talked about leadership across all levels of the club.
Yeah, that's right. She actually went as far as saying that Revolt's legacy pretty much had been called into question.
Yeah, that's right.
She said more or less that a lot of the leadership work he'd maybe done in years previous is kind of all gone to waste to a degree. Do you think she was a bit harsh on...
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you could say, well, he was at the centre of... You could say he was at the centre of probably the most infamous off-field, out-of-season indiscretion. No, I think he's done too much for the club, on and off the field. There's certainly been some off moments, but to say that Clint Jones, to put it simply, being a dickhead and lighting someone on fire is partly Nick Riewoldt's fault.
Mm.
No.
I would agree that, you know, there should have been, you know, leaders such as Riewoldt and others were obviously there, and, you know, why wasn't there a stronger presence around Clint Jones or whoever was involved?
Well, the thing that was even more disappointing, you say leaders were there, it was Lee Montagna, who is a leader of the club,
yeah,
and one of the most senior members of the club, who organised the whole thing.
Yeah.
Which I think is really, really disappointing.
Yeah, there's no getting around that, basically. Yeah. I guess with Caro, getting back to Caro, the bit I disagree with is that kind of, this incident in particular has kind of washed away any of the leadership that he's shown over the last few years. And she was basically saying that he's, in his remaining year or two, he's got to, you know, salvage something leadership-wise. And I couldn't agree with that wholeheartedly.
No, I think it's very harsh.
But at the same time, I mean, Caro's been smelling some smoke around St Kilda since the Sam Fisher rumours and his removal from the leadership group happened prior to the season. And
there's always smoke around St Kilda.
But as the Essendon saga proved once and for all, if anyone else needed any convincing, when she usually sees smoke, then there's usually some fire.
Yeah.
So it's not that pleasing for Saints fans.
Right, so if we'd done this 3 days ago, we might have been talking about whether Scott Waters should be getting another year on his contract. Obviously, we can't just say... Obviously, we can't make a call on... Well, we're not in the club. We can't make a call on that definitively. I mean, okay, if Finey hadn't said all this stuff...
Get rid of him.
If Finey hadn't said all this stuff last night... Now, that's a stupid question. We're cutting that out.
Well, the question about what is contract extension, should he get one or not, basically, is still up in the air.
Up in the air. Do you think... I mean, okay, were you... Okay, who, 2 days what, ago...
Where?
two days ago,
yeah.
Were you keen on an extension either way?
2 days ago. I'd have to lean towards, yeah.
Okay, and what about now?
No.
Do you think Finey's onto something here?
I guess I listened to this Finey thing, and I'm not sure whether it's 100% rubbish or not, but we've seen too many examples in the past of the Saints screwing up in these kind of precarious kind of situations. And so that does make me... think that, yeah, there is fire where this smoke is happening.
Mm.
That sounds really stupid, but I guess I'm thinking that I have to say what transpires over the off season, because this is pretty much, this next couple of months is more critical pretty much than the previous 6 or 7 months in some way.
Yeah. In some ways. Yeah, I'd agree with that.
I guess I posted a post on Scott Waters a few days back, mainly about his interview with Libby Gore, and I did say in the article that I think he showed last year that he definitely can coach, but I maybe wasn't that clear in saying whether I think he should be the coach going forward. And I guess these rumblings and stuff are making me think twice about whether he's got everyone singing from the same hymn book. I think he's shown that he's demonstrated that he can coach, that he can really communicate well with the young guys. But whether he's the best man going forward is still up in the air. Well, how many of the youngsters do you think really progressed to your liking this year? Like, what was your overall impression of how the youngsters went this year?
I liked I should have written notes. I liked Jack Hughes.
Webster.
Nah.
Ferg Berger.
Ferg, no. Nathan Wright.
He was a beauty.
But it was strange because he actually finished the season at Sandy.
Yeah, that was odd. The thing that stood out the most for me, other than his awesome debut, which I think I said at the time was the best that I can remember, even going back to last Luke one, Balls or Del Santos.
Well, the last one I can remember being that good is Brett Knowles, 30 touches wow. against Adelaide.
That's a long way back.
Was 93-98.
Okay.
On Easter Sunday.
That's 15 years. Aside from that awesome debut, the first game against Carlton where he broke his jaw, were you there?
Yeah, he got it was a really awkward collision.
Yeah, he got on his back. Bumped by, I think, Eddie Betts in the back pocket. And that was about midway through the third term. And what stood out to me was when he went off, I think I said to you at the time, the team was actually noticeably worse because yeah, Nathan that's right. Wright went off and the guy behind me was shouting out at him saying, oh, who the hell are you, basically. But the team was actually worse, a worse team when he went off. And I think that was a pretty big kind of plaudit for a first year guy when there's that much of a noticeable difference. He really wore Eddie Betts like a glove for most of the night, and he's got pace, he's got awesome attack on the ball, he runs and carries, and he's a better kick than I forecasted in the podcast at the start.
Yeah, okay.
So I think he was a standout, definitely.
Yeah, my other standout was, well, standout for mine was Tom Lee. Big Tommy Lee. He's not the youngest guy, obviously. He's 21. He might be 22 by now.
And he's not the biggest.
And he's not the biggest. His hair's the biggest.
He's got a big high five on him.
He's got a huge high five. I think as we were discussing in the last game at Livewire in the third quarter, I think he's number one for being first to the goal kicker for a high five for the season.
Yeah, he was a real kind of surprise packet because midway through the year, he'd only really played against Swans. That was his debut.
He played GWS.
And the Swans.
And the Swans. I think that might have been it. And he just had, as Waters said, through the year, he had a couple of injuries, just niggling injuries throughout the year. But once he came back, I think he kicked, I think it was 13 or 14 goals in 5 games or something.
Yeah. I think he had 5 games in a row where he kicked 2 goals, at least.
I think he kicked 2-2, 3-3-3.
Okay.
Yeah.
And
all of a sudden he was an actual legitimate forward target who actually had an impact on games. Like the Carlton game, I know we lost, but in the third quarter he got the Saints right back in. He kicked 2 goals.
Yeah.
Back to back.
And we have to mention that kicking style.
Well, it's textbook.
It's textbook, but it's gone beyond textbook with that head movement. But it just seemed like such a big turnaround, because I remember us going out to Casey and watching the pre-season game against Melbourne. He kicked 0 goals, 4, I think, at least. Right, yeah. He did, and he couldn't hit the side of the barn pretty much with his kicking. Yeah. His marking wasn't great either, but those two things improved dramatically.
That was the thing. His marking wasn't great, but the thing was he got to so many contests, he still got a bit of the ball,
which is
a really good thing. And by the end of the year, he still wasn't taking everything. It still hit only his first season that he's just played. But he was taking a lot more marks and in good positions as well, not just in dangerous positions up forward, but further up the ground as well.
How do you see him going next year? What can we really realistically expect from him?
How many goals did he end up with this year? Yeah, so he kicked 17 goals this year, which was third on the goal kicking, by the way. What can we expect? Well, hopefully he's a bit fitter. And he does tend to go in and out of games still. I mean, that does come with inexperience, but hopefully he'll be, as a mature age recruit, he'll be able to work on that next year and fast track that side of his game. So hopefully a bit fitter so he can cover a bit more ground. Rewalt will still be there, and ideally Rewalt will still be playing just about every week.
Yeah.
So he's still going to be playing a role where he's somewhere between the second forward but occasionally being the number one target.
So far to me, he seems most at home from the goal square to 40 metres out, rather than up the ground. Would you agree?
I think he does. When he goes up the ground, he probably... I think he's still learning how to play up the ground. I mean, it's a different style of game up the ground, obviously. He's probably not quite a pack marker, so he can't take the bigger marks in the contest and be the link man between defence and attack.
The good thing about him is when he does work up the ground, he's good on the counter attack, running back with the small forwards, because he's so athletic.
Yeah, and that's where his fitness comes into it. He'll be able to do that a bit harder.
Yeah, yeah.
A bit more, and likewise, taking the marks as well. He'll be able to run off an opponent. Obviously, he's not going to have the motor of Rewalt, but he'll be able to burn off an opponent and get onto a lead, which isn't the natural kind of state to be in when you're that far up the ground, but it's his best bet of taking those marks.
Yeah. Talking about fitness, segue alert.
Nice.
Tom Hickey's fitness really improved the last 3-4 weeks, and I think
it did.
With that, he had his performances were much better as well.
I think he played the last 3 weeks how everyone was hoping he'd play from straight off.
Yeah.
He was really good. He covered a lot more ground.
Some of his work at ground level as well was really good. Yeah, he gets down particularly against the Suns.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And even in the last game against Freo, the B-side, I think everyone had a decent game against Freo, but it was the kind of things he was doing. And he took a couple of nice marks. There was one nice mark at half-back. He led Sandy to a ruck contest and took a really nice mark in front of Pavlich.
Oh, that's right. Yep, in the goal square.
You know, that's the kind of thing ruckmen need to do. And it's good that he's already showing that he can do that. And, I mean, the City against Sydney, he did something similar around the ground. He took a few marks.
Yep.
And really made an impact around the ground.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And, yeah, it just seemed to... I think this was mainly due to confidence, but it just flowed through his whole game, really, because I think we saw flashes during the year of some of his tap ability, particularly in the forward line. He really likes going over the back.
Yeah.
But I think it flowed through the rest of his game in the last 2 or 3 games where he started marking the ball better, just looking more comfortable. He kicked a couple of goals in the last couple of games. And I think by the end of the year, the discussion about the ruck prospects going forward is like a legitimate one, because his increasingly good performances were contrasting with McAvoy being so sluggish. I mean, McAvoy was straight to head in the 2017 to 2022 premiership captain.
I think that's what it's called now. 2017 to 2022
2017 to 2022 Premiership Captain Stakes. McAvoy was... I think he was your favourite too.
Well, he was basically the whole field. He was black caviar in that field.
He was.
And now all of a sudden, Hickey's form in the last 2-3 games has got everyone kind of thinking about...
This is the thing, not just McAvoy's leadership qualities, but also is he going to be the number one ruckman in 5 years?
Well, that's what I mean. The thing is as well, and people questioning this about the tricky Hickey. Is that... getting tricky with it. People were questioning this...
Could we just talk about getting Hickey with it? Go on. Did you see it?
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think he has a natural ability for taking the mic.
I think he's sensational. He's the best comedic media performer this club's had for a while. And I mean that in the sort of, he can speak to a different kind. Like, I think people from subcultures would find that funny. I've said to you, he's like having Stephen Merchant as a footballer at the club.
Have you seen...
And it's not just the eyes.
Have you seen Tricky on Instagram?
What's Tricky?
Hickey.
Is that... Okay.
Well, it's funny because it's him. But on top of that, he's got the artistic side as well. You should check out a couple of the pieces he's done on Instagram.
Really?
Yeah, so...
Really? But I think he's a good actor. Great comedic actor.
Multi-talented. Yeah. Anyway, what was I talking about with
you? 2017's 22 Premiership Captain. McAvoy.
Oh, I was saying, when people were questioning this about the Hickey acquisition from the get-go, in terms of, say he does reach the potential that we all hope he reaches, how does he fit in the same team with McAvoy? How do they work together?
This is the thing that people might find it hard to comprehend. All of a sudden we're seeing, and it's so far away, you'd think it's so far away. All of a sudden we're seeing a young ruckman with probably better apps than McAvoy on him than McAvoy ever had, suddenly showing something. And that obviously gets everyone's mind going, oh, what could he be? And if he's that good, well, maybe McAvoy's the one where you say, well, how do you fit McAvoy in the team? And that's such a huge hypothetical, but I think that idea might have crossed people's minds. Not for 2014, but for later on.
Does this affect the... Does Hickey's form in the last few rounds affect the trade period in terms of McAvoy?
No. I think McAvoy's still... Well, if it was up to me, I think McAvoy's still needed.
Yeah.
Because Hickey's only played 3 half-decent games for a younger player. But if, from as far as I know, and what would be best for the club, blah, 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 do you think they'd be... Well, I don't know. Do you think they would be? Do you think the club would be looking at it right now?
One thing I do sincerely believe Scott about is him saying that they'll look at all possible options because the situation requires that, basically.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've had a raft of youngsters come through this year, but there's still a lot of work to be done, basically, before we think of really actually jumping up the ladder. So I think they can't not... talk about it.
Yeah.
I mean, when you sit back and you look at the list, we don't want to go into the trade situation too much because we're going to do a separate pod on that before the trade period. But when you sit back and look at the list, like, who do you say is untouchable? Revolt. And that's it?
Jack Stephen,
okay. So basically everyone else has a price.
I think they would.
So, I guess they'd have to think about it, but that said, I think they'd be well reluctant to...
Jack Stephen can't go, he's the song guy now.
Well, we've got merch guy and song guy covered, so up
on the keep hickey type.
And comedian guy.
Yeah.
We've got onwards and upwards from there. Nunes.
Oh, yeah, okay. Well, I was on the Nunes bandwagon. I'm still on his bandwagon. Well, no, that's a lie. I was on the Stanley and Sivos bandwagon.
Yes.
Big time at the start of the year. And they're probably the two younger guys that disappointed us the most this year.
Absolutely.
Sivos finished 2012 really, really well. I mean, he showed some pretty good signs throughout the year anyway. But he just really fell away during the year. And I think he was injured at some points, but he just, when he did come into the side, he just didn't quite seem to be able to get as much of the ball. He was out of the game for longer periods. I'm not sure if playing him down back was the right thing to do in the sense that they kept throwing up forward anyway for occasions. I thought maybe he'd be best just staying put somewhere, learning his role in one position in the ground. He'll be able to do that properly and then work off that, as opposed to maybe getting a bit confused and being thrown around in different roles.
I think it's always risky completely changing the role for someone so early in their career when they haven't even forged themselves in their original position.
Mm.
So I think that was always risky. But you could always make sense of what they were trying to do and trying to mould him into that half-back role because he has such a brilliant kick.
Absolutely, and he's got a... I mean, he's not heavily built, but he's a good size as well for a player of that type.
But I think we witnessed in the first two or three rounds, I'm pretty sure we said it after the round two loss to Richmond, that he just looked lost in the back 50. Did. As well as being down back, he wasn't playing on someone who's playing the loose man role. And as much as people like to kind of palm that kind of role off as an easy ride sometimes, he's still got to know how to play it. And he just really looked lost at times.
He did. I think being accountable for someone would have given him more structure as well if he's going to be playing off half back.
But I kind of felt like his year in some ways... was quite a lot like Stanley's because both of them went into the season with this kind of new role and everyone kind of being excited about
it. Well, both went from being forced to defenders.
Yep. And then come three quarters of the way through the year, people were questioning whether, where the hell do you play these two? Where do you hide them on the ground? Because they're not playing well anywhere.
Yeah. And this is the thing. You look at someone like Jake Carlisle, who's had a bit more game time, but not too much more game time, and he's totally nailing the swingman role.
Yeah.
And obviously he's a different size, so he's got that going for him. I mean, Stanley has a lot going for him, at least in terms of Sivos. But I didn't even get that. Like, I was just like, well, yeah, Stanley's big too. Sorry, you're right. it shows it can be done. So sometimes it does depend on the player. Maybe if you're good enough, you'll be able to take that on board. Or if you're that type of player, you can take it on board. But most players, that's not going to be the case. I just think, I wouldn't say this year was a wasted year, necessarily, for both of them.
Okay.
I mean, there were times this year where Reece going to defence, I think a lot of people believed it might actually work. More so than people... Yes. So,
he did take out Sam Reid very well in that pre-season game.
I went to that pre-season... Okay, I went to the NAV Cup second round game. I think I went by myself. I had an absolute ball because I got to sit in four different places throughout the game. Just by myself, doing whatever the hell I wanted amongst about 18 other people. And I got so excited about Reece Stanley blanketing Sam Reid for 2.5 quarters. And I remember the genuine outrage I felt when Stanley went off.
Yeah.
In the third quarter, because he'd done an absolute number on Reid, and then Reid kicked a goal soon after.
Yeah.
And I just thought, that is so so St Kilda like that we unearth an absolute gem, and then we just lose it straight away.
Yeah.
I was really sold on that.
Yeah.
And I wrote about that in that match report, how over the top I was being, and I know how over the top I was being probably at the time, and right now I do, but I was so into it. On paper, it made perfect sense. He's taller than any other full forward. He's faster than them. He'll blanket them.
You know what, though? On the speed thing, off the mark, he was getting beaten, though. And if you watch him sprint, like, even when he's in space, he...
Even in the grand final sprint of 2009?
let's review the tape. But I reckon he's better through the 20 to 60 metre mark than the 0 to 20 metre mark. Because he was getting done on the lead at times.
0 to 20, you're done by the time. That's it. That's the lead.
Okay, 0 to 10. But do you know what I mean? Like, I think...
He's going to have to get that down to 0 to 2.
I think, well, let me, do you know what?
Mm.
At times during the year, I was thinking Reece's development is almost like going to be the making of breaking of, well, sort of the acid test of how well Waters and the development staff can really develop a player, because Reece is a total project player. He's never, and when people say, oh, he's a natural forward, but the thing is, he's never done well as a forward at any level, really. He's only ever shown glimpses. You couldn't point to a season in his development where it was like, oh, he kicked 60 in the sand for or whatever. So he's a total out-and-out project player.
Mm.
And I yo-yoed during the year between thinking he's going to really define how well we can develop a player, and thinking, no, he is just a Frankenstein kind of thing, and he's most likely not going to become anything.
Well, I'm terrified of that, because as we alluded to before, I'm totally on his bandwagon.
Still?
I'm on the Tom Lee bandwagon now. I'm still on the Rick Stanley bandwagon, but I've got seats at the back.
Yeah.
I'm just hanging out at the back. I'm not really paying attention to where it's going. Or Tom Lee, I'm front and centre.
Yep.
But
you're giving him a high five.
I'll be first to give him a high five.
Yeah.
After he's kicked any goal.
Yeah.
But I just think it'll be so disappointing. Because in theory, he makes so much sense.
Yep.
And in theory, he could be anything, and he could be this amazing player.
Well, in theory, he has all the tools. Like I said before, he has the height and he has the speed combination, which we've seen across the league. There's many players. Buddy's the obvious one, but if you have height and speed, like, that's just a lethal combination if you can get it together.
And I think it might have been born out of maybe a sort of late Ross Lyon era acknowledgement that Rue and these guys aren't going to be around. They're going to be around for a bit longer, but not too much longer. And because we didn't have anyone coming through, really. I think maybe for some people in the back of their heads, they were looking for a get out of jail free card.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Reece Stanley was that for me.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Just after this year, I know he was injured as well, but he was also pretty rubbish at times.
Oh, well, he got injured in the end, but his confidence was absolutely shot prior to that. And I think even though our low defensive stocks were absolutely empty by that point, he still, I think, should have been demoted had he not gotten injured at that point. Because
I don't think many people would have disagreed with you.
Because he just looked just shot for confidence completely. And
which is also a shame for all the pugs out there. Because he does such good work with Pugs SOS. So that alone, I'd keep him on the list.
Yeah.
And that alone, don't trade him, don't offer him up for any picks, don't just keep him there.
Yeah.
He's got Pugs with him. And Sipos.
Sipos. For me, Sipos has an out, really, because, yeah, he really did have some injury concerns. That's shoulder.
Yeah.
I think we was giving him some grief, and even when he was playing some games in the second half of the year, he still looked really hampered by the shoulder. He's played 9 games for the year. So if you had told me he's going to play 9 games for the year this year and average, 10 disposals a game, which is less than last year, I'd be pretty disappointed. And like you said, the two flagship kind of young guys from last year were Stanley and Tsipos. But yeah, it's hard to... you can't completely be as critical of Tsipos as you can be with Stanley because, yeah, A, Tsipos had some injury concerns, and B, no, I don't know if there's another reason, but he did have some injuries concerns. But for me, going forward, Tsipos is a forward. I think you have to shelve the idea of him playing as a backman. He just looked completely lost, and he's just such a natural forward.
Yeah, that's where he played all his junior footy.
Yeah. His nous around goal is too much of a weapon.
He's a good lead-up player. He's got a great kick.
But let me ask you, injury or no injury, I still had my doubts in the second half of the year whether he's got the speed for the modern game. Because I think I mentioned in a couple of the match reviews, he was just getting burnt off when we didn't have the footy.
Well, this is the thing, because he did end up... And I'm thinking specifically the Geelong game,
yeah,
which was later in the season. That sticks in my mind as one where he just looked really out of his depth. I'm thinking that might have been something to do with his injury. And I'm certainly saying that in hope that it was something to do with his injury. I don't know, maybe another pre-season. This is only his third year. He's played 25 games.
Yeah.
I'm willing to give him a lot more time.
Yeah. Yeah, fair enough.
But I think the thing is, if he hadn't shown such good signs in his second year, we probably wouldn't be so
harsh on him.
Yeah, maybe so harsh on him. We've had pretty high expectations basically since his first game, and he kicked that goal towards the end, that long goal.
Yeah,
I think everyone got a bit excited about him.
Yeah, just a quick word or two on some of the other debutants. Murdoch,
really, I was surprised he got dropped late in the season against the Hawks. Did some really good contested stuff. He only got 7 touches that game, but he took some really nice marks.
His game against Freo really stood out for me. At Patterson's.
That's right.
I'm pretty sure he played a run with roll / half back. I think in his last couple of games against the Hawks and the Suns, they tried to use him more up forward.
Yeah, they did actually.
He's got a great kick.
He's got a great kick, and he's got a good mark as well.
Well, he's really good size already.
But even for his size, he's really good above his head. With his hands up.
I think he looked really good every time he got the ball. It's just a matter of him really
getting the ball.
Developing the tank, and I could really see him being like a defensive sort of half forward maybe.
Yeah.
Because he's got really good size. Yeah. But hopefully he can go through the midfield as well.
Yeah, absolutely, but I'm really pleased with that, with his output for a first-year player.
What about Saunders?
In my mind, I sort of put Saunders and Murdoch, not together because they're very different players, but I think they got taken in similar spots in the draft. Murdoch was picked 40, Saunders is picked 43.
Yep.
So I think they're just in my head a little intertwined. But Saunders, Saunders, likewise, I think they played a similar amount of games as well.
For me, Saunders...
wasn't finished.
Okay.
But I really like Saunders because he is really, really willing. Again, for a first-year player, I like that he was really, really willing to take on his opponent and attempt to run around them or burn them with the footy.
He had that bit of craziness like Nathan Wright did, where he absolutely was just beelining the footy.
Absolutely, and they're the kinds of players that I like having at the club that Scott Waters has brought in.
I think aside from the fact that he was wearing number 35, I think that was one of the main reasons that people kind of took to him straight away because... Yeah.
Oh, my dad said just to add to that, my dad said he looks like Frank Coughlin.
Oh, that's true, with the kind of
Slightly receding hairline. Unkempt hair and the nose as well.
Yeah, that's true actually.
Sorry, go on.
Yeah, I was just saying, yeah, it became a fan favourite. And I was going to say, he was more of a surprise to me than Murdoch. Because Murdoch, a lot of people were saying, oh, his brother had been picked up by Geelong. And Murdoch had played against seniors. And he'd obviously, physically, he looked really ready to make an impact this year. But I would have never have guessed that Saunders would have played as much as he did. And He probably much more than Murdoch in my mind, he actually had a real tangible impact on some of the games. Like the Port Adelaide game where he had 18 touches was really noticeable. And the Freo game as well, where he had a couple of assists in that one, I'm pretty sure. He had that really impressive
first. And he kicked a really nice goal in that one as well.
Yeah. And he's one of those guys that looks like, hopefully, he's got a good combination of the hardness at the ball and speed.
Absolutely.
He was playing a lot around the half forward line and he was using that speed to good effect. So with the pre-season under his belt, hopefully he can play a bit more in the midfield next year. But he was certainly a good surprise back in.
Now, what did you think of going a bit older now, but still a debutant, likely, Tom Curran?
Look, I was sceptical at first of people being so excited about him just because I have a natural scepticism about guys really slogging it out at VFL for 2 or 3 years and people getting overly excited about that because so often we see players not being able to make the jump.
Mm.
And at the same time, the coaching staff and football department really left his elevation onto the main list quite late in the year, even though he'd been playing so well.
Yep.
And even though there was definitely room for him to be elevated.
Absolutely.
So that also made me a bit suspicious. But by the end of the year, it was him, Big Tom Lee, and Big Tom Hickey that kind of really came home with a wet sail to really kind of salvage something from the development kind of standpoint, in my opinion.
Because
he was just really good. Even the things that people were knocking him on, such as his disposal, turned out to be furphies, really.
Well, I remember, I think every Sandringham game, and when I say every, I mean a couple, that I've seen since Curran's been on the list have been with you.
Yeah.
And what I saw of Curran, it did sort of match up with what people were saying. The knocks on his disposal were probably a bit too harsh, I thought, but I could understand them. And what I saw of him, there was his disposal was still looked like enough that it might be something that would keep him out of an AFL side.
Yep.
I was really, really surprised, not just how much of the ball he got at AFL level, but how half-decently he used it as well.
Yep.
Not just
blazing away.
Not just blazing away, but it was also pretty creative.
Oh, yeah,
it was
absolutely.
Pretty creative with it, happy to sit on it. And he actually kicked a few goals as well,
yep.
Which was a really, really good sign.
I think it helped as well. Not just for Curran, but for all the youngsters in the last few rounds. But just as a side, we just got things together a little bit more in those last few rounds. And I think moving Del Santo back behind the ball, we seemed to have a lot more possession. And I think that kind of benefited guys like Curran, Murdoch, everyone kind of playing around the half-forward line. We're just seeing a lot more on the ball. Not to take anything away from Curran, but when I spoke to you post the BNF, Curran obviously won
the... What did you say?
Was that worst?
Curran... What were you trying to say? What did you mix it up with?
I'm not sure.
One most.
Yeah,
go on.
He won most professional award, was it? The Robert Harvey one?
Yeah.
And that was no surprise, really, because...
Have you seen his arms?
Yeah, his arms and just from everything coming out of the club, he seemed to be a really dedicated guy, no matter what you thought of how he actually played on the field. But I was saying to you after the BNF, he just spoke so well, especially even though he's been around the club for a few years now, he he just spoke really maturely compared to some of the other young guys. And
I think that comes from his days as being a merch guy.
That's a big mantle to step into, so you got to grow up fast.
If he's not the merch guy next year, I don't know who is.
I don't know if he'll have time. He's got bigger fish to fry now. He's got to pass the baton on to...
Who does he pass the baton on to?
Minchington, maybe?
I reckon Nathan Wright. He's pretty good looking.
But Curran, yeah, I was just... Surely he's a lock-in to be drafted onto the main list.
You would really, really think so. I mean, they kept playing him, so...
I think if another team kind of swooped in somehow to pinch him from underneath St Kilda, I think I dare say someone would bird down Seaford because he's the people's champion.
He's very popular.
Let me put it to you like this. Curran or Ledger?
Curran.
Yeah.
Curran or Ledger?
Curran, yeah. Every day of the week.
What do you think of Ledger?
I think he's gone. And
now, I heard a rumour. It might have been on a forum, which I'll just call for...
Is it Tony from Geelong?
Tony from Geelong. Or a forum which, for discretion's sake, we'll call Sensational. Ledger for Viv Mitchie.
Vivian Mitchie.
It's not Mitchie. I always say Mitch. It's Mitchie.
We've already got the Minch.
We've got the Minch. Oh, there's another one we've got to talk about.
Well, I read that same rumour, and it seems like it was an oft-repeated one. Like, there seems to be a fair few people catching on to it.
There's going
to
be thousands of rumours between now and the next few weeks. It makes sense in the sense that Ledger goes to Freo, where he's reunited with Ross, who obviously liked him. Plus, he gets to go home.
Exactly.
And then Mishy gets to come home
to
Melbourne.
And Mishy is starved for opportunity at Freo as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
They've got a fair bit of depth in that midfield.
Yeah,
Mishy, I think it was taken in 2010. I think this was his third year, but I think this has been the only year where it's been fit for Freo. But he's basically a quick midfielder is what I'm reading.
Mm.
My read on it is I reckon he's gone. I don't think there's any reason other than the coaching staff doesn't really rate him or doesn't see him at the club next year. There's no reason why they wouldn't have played him otherwise.
Yeah. It was very suspect.
And I think it kind of felt like a token kind of send-off in some ways those last couple of games. Credit where it's due, he did play pretty well in
those
last couple of games.
He did. He played, I think, 1.5 games and he... One game and a quarter and a bit.
Yeah, that's right.
And he was actually pretty good.
Yeah.
Throughout the whole
thing. If he does go, I won't be losing any sleep over it because I don't think he's a real game changer in terms of the position we're in at the minute.
No.
Seb Ross was in his second year.
It was a good year.
For Seb.
I like him. I really like him. He just looks like he's getting a lot more comfortable with the pace of the game and the physicality of the game as well. He's not afraid to get low to the ball and get low quite quickly. And by the end of the year, we're seeing him get out a lot of quick handballs.
He loves the handball.
Do you know who else loved the handball, Rich?
Who's that?
Dean Polo.
Well, if that's what he's aspiring to, then... He's on his way to greatness, obviously. But he ended up playing 13 matches for the year. But I've got to say, his last two or three, where he came in for the last three games of the year, I wasn't so impressed by those. I was more impressed during the middle of the year, actually.
Just looking at his stats sheet for the year, I actually thought he got better at what he was meant to be doing in those last few games.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he was a bit more effective in what he was doing. He was getting out quick handballs in situations where we actually did need a player getting low and making a physical contest.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he didn't necessarily... He got 22 touches in that last game, which was equal season high. But the other two games, he only got 14, which wasn't his highest. And a lot of those... If you actually look at the kicks and handballs, it's almost all handballs. Exactly. But I think that just showed he was given a role and they just said, do this, and he's done it.
Yeah.
And I thought he did it for someone in his second year. And when you say second year, it's someone who... Second year in the system, but who only played one game the year before.
Yeah.
I thought he did pretty well.
Yeah, I don't think there was anything outstanding about his year. I mean, his game against Bulldogs, he actually stood out quite a bit because quite a lot of our midfield were pretty awful that night.
I mean, just on that, he doesn't stand out much anyway because he plays such an unassuming kind of role.
Yeah, true.
It's not a very... He doesn't do many flashy things.
No, true. That's true. What I was going to say, though, was even though it wasn't an outstanding year, it was just a good stepping stone year, I guess. Yeah, and definitely. If you can have that same level of improvement next year, then I think we'll be pretty excited about him this time next year, hopefully.
Yeah, definitely.
But he's just got to, he's really good to, got to just build that tank, I guess. Like a lot of the young guys, like it's going to be another big pre-season for him. And
yeah.
Jack Stephen, the best and fairest winner, we haven't really addressed that much, but he attributed his big rise in performance this year down to a massive preseason.
He did.
And, you know, that's got to really be where these guys like Sebros really earn their pay and really lift their game is through these next few months, really, to lay that platform.
Very much agreed.
You want to talk about Dylan Robertson? He was the early
people. No, you wanted to talk about Dylan
Robertson. He was the people's champion Mark One before Curran swooped in.
Now, the other thing that I got out of that second round NAB Cup game against Sydney was that Robertson was rubbish. This is the same game that I thought Reece Stanley was the answer to all our defensive woes.
Yeah.
And I was wrong on both counts, obviously, because Robertson actually ended up being really quite... Not just getting a lot of the ball when kicking it to the right person, but being pretty creative and playing with a bit of flair.
Yeah, yeah. He slotted in really well. And he played a lot in that loose man position. Yeah, and like you say, he was quite creative, and I think that's why a lot of people took to him. He got a lot of footy. He put his body on the line despite being like quite a light frame. Yeah, he was really effective. He did drop away in the second half of the year, but I think come the end of the first half of the year, you would have almost penciled him in for the top three and the best and fairest.
Well, if he kept playing that way, you wouldn't have been surprised at a pretty high finish. I'm actually surprised at how well he slid into the team.
Yeah.
You'd think we had enough of that type of player.
Yeah. We were really struggling to see if he'd... fit into that back six at the start of the year. Well, because
I remember thinking that at the in that NAB Cup game, there was a 2 or 3 minute sort of, might have been a bit more, might have been 5 minutes. He got two kicks, which he just, when he was in space, which he just absolutely rushed off half back, kicking it to, you know, just forward of the wing. And he botched both of them and he looked really uncomfortable. It looked like he didn't know what he was meant to be doing.
Yeah.
Didn't know where he was meant to be kicking it, let alone kicking it properly. A week later, we both went to Casey Fields to watch that Melbourne game, which you mentioned before. And I think the coaches might have told him to just keep things simple.
Yeah.
And from memory, every time he got the ball, he just went short and sideways. And he kept it really, really, really simple. And from that point, I think they might have just given him a bit more direction and a bit more confidence, and I think it might have grown from there.
Well, he's obviously gotten up over 50 games now, so he's really one of our few players who's in that prime slot in terms of the amount of years of being in the system and the amount of games they've been able to rack up in terms of really seeing them kick along in their development now and really actually being really realistic about them really contributing week to week. Yeah, it's really promising to see how it went this year because he's only got 50-something games under his belt, so hopefully his best is going to come in the next 2 or 3 years.
I think it will. And I think you said he sort of faded a bit towards the end of the year. He played 20 games this year, which is clearly the most he's ever played in one season. So I think with another pre-season.
Well, I think it was a bit of that, and it was a bit of he wasn't playing loose man anymore. I think he was playing as a traditional defender much more, and people, some teams weren't allowing him to be the loose man. So he just didn't have that freedom to just be able to sweep up packs and come in as the third man and so on. So it's going to be interesting to see where he slots in terms of, is he the loose man? Is he the third tall defender?
Especially assuming we'll have a full bill of health, clean bill of health.
Yeah.
By the end of the preseason.
I mean, going off of the 2 years that Scott's been in charge of the team so far, I think he much prefers that kind of Robertson type of defender to a Gwilt type.
Are we going through the whole fucking list?
There's been a lot of debutants.
Seriously? What are we up to? Still got...
There's Ferguson, Tom, do you want to quickly talk about Shenton, Minchington and Ferguson?
Shenton, yeah. Minchington, yeah. Ferguson,
Yeah, it will be interesting to see how many of those three will be at the club next year. I think
Minchington will be.
Yeah, Minchington did enough. But the other two, I'm not sure.
He played 2 games, but he showed enough in a limited... Yeah. Viceroy. Early in the
morning. Just trying to let the sun... Tom, were there any highlights that you could extract from the year?
The 140-year jumper.
Yep.
I would say that's my favourite St Kilda jumper ever.
Wow.
Maybe take the names off.
Mm-hmm.
And it's my favourite St Kilda jumper ever.
Oh, take the names off and it looks 10 times better. No disrespect to anyone.
No disrespect to every St Kilda player ever.
It's a great sentiment, but just didn't look so good on telly.
Oh, I thought it looked sensational.
Well, I just mean with the names on. Take away the names, and I think it would have been...
No, because at the ground, it certainly looked amazing. Yeah. But it would look even... The colours would be a bit bolder.
Yeah.
Without the names. But that was my highlight of the year. And also the fact we won that game. That was a good win.
Well, yeah, that was genuinely a win against decent opposition.
Yeah. And, of course, the last round.
Yeah.
That was...
Did it feel like the glory days?
No, it didn't feel like the glory days, and I mean that. And then it didn't feel like the glory days, but it felt like a celebration of something good that did happen.
Yeah,
and it was a really nice day.
You wrote a very touching article about Cozzy. Do you want to have any final words on Cozzy and Blakey and Milne? It was a big year for Stephen.
I'll just get upset. Cozzy, he was one player I really, really, really wish made it. And yeah. I think if he was a fourth round pick, I don't think he'd cop so much.
Oh, definitely not.
But I was always... I was always on his side.
Yeah.
And I wish he got more out of his career.
Yeah. It was pretty interesting that he came out with those comments about not enjoying his footy for the latter years of his career.
Yeah, that was... I think he showed himself to be a lot more... I don't know, maybe if he played 10 years earlier.
Oh,
he would have...
Yeah.
Not just physically, but his attitude as well.
Yeah.
And I don't mean he had a bad attitude. I just think the game was a different kind of beast to what he might have been expecting it to be.
Yeah. Absolutely. Blakey, he was an absolute... Just ultimate team player. Ultimate Mr. Fix-It. And, probably more so than the other two. He actually finished the year playing some good footy.
Yeah, I thought I actually thought I wouldn't mind him here next year.
It's just a shame that we didn't really have a real up-and-coming defender that he could mentor this year. I mean, obviously Jackson Ferguson and Simpkin and the likes of those guys were there, but they're not genuine fullbacks.
Well, no, it was he. he wasn't a genuine anything.
Well, that's right, but he'd have a lot of wisdom in his brain as to how to extract the best out of himself.
Absolutely. I think the fact that he wasn't a genuine anything was both the most remarkable and unremarkable thing about him.
Yeah, totally. It's so funny that he was one of the biggest whipping boys ever during particularly the Ross Lyon era. And then by this year, everyone was shouting from the balcony as to how underrated he's been.
Well, and also the club actually found itself in a position that actually needed someone like him.
Yeah.
Quite genuinely.
He was genuinely very good last year. Like, because we had those injury problems early in the year with McAvoy and such, and Fisher as well.
Yep.
And he was playing ruck, and he was playing some of the best footy of his career.
It's just an awkward time for a player like him.
Yeah.
In terms of being in this club. But I like that he was never, ever front and centre, but I like that he had his moment.
In the sun.
In the sun in that last game. Yeah. He deserved it.
Milne?
Well, unfortunately, it's to be continued. Ultimately.
We'll definitely see more of him in the media.
Yeah, no, that's what I mean. Yeah. There'll be more things that will happen quite publicly to him that will define how we view him. Whichever way.
Yeah. It's just such a shame as well that his final year was kind of such a low point compared to the high standards he's had on the field the last half a dozen years.
You're talking
years
on the least. Field.
On the field,
just on the field alone.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure how much the off-field dramas had on how much effect that had on his performance this year, but yeah, he really under-delivered on what I thought he'd produce this year. But at the same time, granted, playing that small forward position in such a struggling team is a tough gig.
Absolutely. And how well has he played it for how long as well? Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to begrudge him a bad season of footy.
Yeah. But I think off-field dramas aside, I would have definitely chopped him at the end of this year.
Well, I think so. Likewise, Blake. It's time. Lowlights. Rich, what were your lowlights?
The one that springs to mind. Oh, actually, well, that is a tough one, to be honest.
You can pick several because they were.
Well, the one that first came to mind was the Kangaroos game. I mean, we can talk about the records that were broken in the Geelong loss.
Yes.
Yeah, it was the first 100-point defeat in what, 10 years?
Since round 4. 2002, which was against Geelong at Geelong.
Yeah. So we can talk about how, obviously it's woeful to get beaten by over 100 points, but at the same time, Geelong's a champion team, and I think that result was less surprising than getting walloped by a Kangaroos team that didn't manage to make the finals, even though I think most people acknowledge that they are probably better than the latter shows them to be.
Absolutely.
But I think the Geelong result was still probably less surprising than the Kangaroos one. And the Kangaroos one, it was just so disappointing to be blown out of the water within 5 minutes. And I think it came at a really, where it came kind of smack bang in the middle of the year where, when you're a really struggling team, being in the middle of the year, it feels like a really long season. And at that point, having just lost to the lowly Bulldogs, then to come out the next week and get absolutely walloped in the first 5 minutes by a middle-of-the-table team was just really shattering. And it really spoke of kind of the psyche of the team. You know, when you don't come out to play like that, it leaves you wondering where the sides, exactly. Know, whether the wheels are really falling off completely.
Exactly, and that was a very cold Sunday twilight game.
Yeah.
And a few weeks later, we lost to Richmond in a very similar way at the MCG, and that was a twilight game too. And they're the kind of days where you don't really get anything out of them.
Yeah.
You get walloped. The younger guys probably don't show much, and the senior guys aren't giving you much either. It's just a loss across the board.
Yeah. So that was one that stood out. Funnily enough, the week before was another contender against the Bulldogs because that was a game where we had some genuine enthusiasm in terms of what the result could bring.
That was one of the very few weeks we did.
Exactly, and they just didn't come to play in that first quarter. The Bulldogs just wanted it more, basically, and it was one of those weeks where Scott's line about the side being so young, I think, just didn't wash with me because they just definitely didn't reach the standard of endeavour that you need at this level. They just didn't want it.
Yeah, and the Bulldogs finished the year pretty well, but they were a pretty different side at that point in time as well. So that was definitely disappointing to be overrun by a team like that as well.
Yeah. Another lowlight was... Jeez, there's a lot of contenders.
Are you talking about on the field?
Well, either way. Yeah, I mean, Sard was another one that was a real kind of knife getting twisted in the back.
That's still got some water to go under the bridge.
Yeah.
But I think we all know the end result. And we're talking statistically, that's not conjecture. It's a very unexpected shame. I mean, he wasn't the same kind of player player this year as he was the year before.
No.
Much like Malera. But both for him and the club, it's probably going to be a really sad outcome.
Well, yeah, it was a real kick in the guts when, you know, everyone was still trying to swallow what a bleak year it was.
Yeah.
On one hand, it still seems like a bit of a... The penalty to me seems out of whack with what occurred. But at the same time, obviously, people know what the rules are.
Yeah, absolutely. They're pretty straightforward.
Yeah. That was definitely a low light, yeah.
I mean, well, we've gone over Milne as well. And then, obviously, at the end of the season... Okay, we went over this before, but the fact that Lee Montagna ordered dwarf entertainers at Mad Monday was really embarrassing. I pay $660 for my membership every year, and I actually pay that. My parents don't pay it for me anymore, and I don't do it. My membership fees aren't there so they can use it on hiring dwarf entertainers. I know the players need some sort of space from the club at the end of the season, obviously, but there needs to be some sort of agreement on what goes on a Mad Monday when you've got guys who get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars who've been under quite high degrees of pressure all year and they decide to have a drink times 30 all day. I thought it was really embarrassing for the club.
Absolutely. Like Sard situation, it was just another real kick in the guts that that we could have really done without. I guess unlike Sard though, it's something that kind of gets smeared across the whole playing group and the whole club because whenever something like this comes up, straight away all the blah, blah, blah happens about, you know, the errors gone by and the culture and everything is dredged up that the club's been trying to shed the last 10 years at least. It's just really disappointing that a guy of the experience of Lee Montagna is involved in such a way and he should just clearly know better. And
I mean, that letter that was published... past the letter that were published in a day or two after, was really pathetic on his part, I thought.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand, not, I understand in the sense that, yes, I acknowledge the fact that players were lighting each other on fire, like, as a prank.
Yeah.
And I can kind of get that if you're in on it.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, to a point. But to light someone on fire, like, who's just totally not in on it and totally not consenting to being lit on fire is ridiculous.
Yeah. I agree that, obviously, the playing group needs its space and it needs its, you know, time outside of footy to do whatever it is they need to do to just disconnect.
Mm.
But when things like disrespectful things like this happen, it just really can only make things more difficult for them in the future in terms of getting this time. And
yeah,
because you know, executives and whatnot are only going to crack down on it more at St Kilda or otherwise, probably at all the clubs.
Mm.
And it's been mentioned in the media that AFL honchos were at the clubs only a week or two before warning against this exact kind of behaviour. And you could kind of get your head around it to a degree if it was a insert first year or second year player here. But when it's Clint Jones and Montagna who have been around the traps well long enough, then it's, yeah, it's even more disappointing. And I just feel sorry as well for the executive at the club, because it's not like the sponsorship's been flowing through the door the last few years. Even though we've had such a successful decade through the noughties, etc. So it was a real punch in the face.
Yeah, and after, it was what, 2 days after that last game, that was really disappointing.
Yeah. But what I don't get as well is there were Saints fans around the interwebs and blah, blah, blah.
Mm, sensational.
Twitter, etc.
Yeah, you know who you are.
Trying to downplay it, saying, you know, just having a bit of fun, you know, storm a teacup, you know, media just pumping up the whole St Kilda disco kind of rubbish. And yeah, they might have been sensationally making more of it than it was, but we can't just stand for this any longer. And the club's in a difficult position as it is on the field, let alone these things coming up.
Mm.
And they do really matter. Like, yeah, getting sponsorship through the door really matters. Getting corporate support really matters. Like, going through the draft with the number 3 pick isn't going to just be a cure-all.
Mm.
We need to be hitting home runs, you know, financially as well, to lift ourselves out of the mire. So,
yep.
Having St Kilda's name attached to anything like this instantly really has a knock-on effect on like all those aspects. You can't downplay that.
One more. Yeah, oh, the video. Fuck. All right. Who did it? Is this the worst podcast?
Why?
For me personally, you've been sensational.
No, I've done nothing.
All right, Luke. I know.
Yeah.
Luke. All right.
We came across this video in the most... And we're talking about G Virgin Australia.
All right, wait, hang on. Let me introduce it first. Now, I think we've got through all the requests. And when I say all the requests, I mean all three. What do we got? All right, Luke259, at Luke259 on Twitter. We spoke about Finey. Osgoon, what, at Osgoon1, the Pelican. We're talking to Rich. I was talking to Rich before. We spoke about Pelican a bit before, but I reckon we'll have a bumper Pelican edition when we have our podcast around draft time, because he'll have everything to do with that one. So stay tuned. Going back to at Luke259, he also wanted to know our thoughts on the video entry that St Kilda's put in for the Virgin Australia Film Festival. Now there's 30 plane tickets on the line here.
Yep.
To the US or just wherever. Okay, well, apparently some other clubs have done it as well.
Freo's is rubbish, Tom. Just to make
Freo's is rubbish. Yeah. I bet you it's a novelty entry.
We came across this the St Kilda video in the weirdest circumstances.
Now, it was Richie's birthday on Saturday, and we were at the Union, just off Smith Street in Collingwood, waiting for our Palmers to arrive, and the big screen had the Sydney-Carlton semi-final. And Channel 7 showed the video as just a bit of pre-match entertainment.
But there was no sound.
But there was no sound. So Rich and I watched this. What were you feeling, Rich? What were you feeling without the sound?
Just pure WTF. Like, seriously, we were just flabbergasted. By that point, we were not fully drunk. We were just flabbergasted. I didn't know what the hell it was.
And what did you think when you saw the video? Okay, with the sound?
When I saw it properly, I mean, my highlight from it was that Jordan Staley got a gig.
Jordan Staley gets his first airtime on a commercial network. Not in a St Kilda jumper, not the Zebras jumper.
Yeah, that's right. He got a fair go. Jay Lever got thrown
Jay
in.
Jay Lever? Spencer White got a nice shot.
Spencer nice White shot was working the vocals.
Sam Donnell.
Sam Donnell is getting right into it. Big Tommy Lee was getting some good coverage.
A lot of the kids, it was good to say.
Yeah, TDL was even there.
TDL and Saad. I wonder when it was shot. Now, my question is, who decided that they're wearing their Clash jumper in the rooms after they've chosen footage of them walking off in their home jumper after a win? Bit of a continuity error there.
Well, it's a continuity gap that's akin to the last year's premiership video. I remember you pointing out the guy going out to shake Dempster's hand or whatever wearing a blue jacket.
That wasn't a continuity thing. That was just a, why would you choose blue? Why wouldn't you choose one of the club's colours? Looks like some guy just broke into the room. But also, the fact that they're wearing their Clash jumper in a video that they know is going to get a lot of views.
Yeah.
That's a really deliberate decision that they made. Maybe not as deliberate as having Jordan Staley in there.
It's probably Jordan Staley's equivalent of a send-off. I mean,
they didn't give him the farewell game in the last round.
When people YouTube Jordan Staley in a few years, they'll just be that 2 second clip of him getting all the pop song on us.
Now, highlight for the video for mine was Nick Riewoldt. He's relatively good acting for a footballer. I thought he nailed that bit.
Trust St Kilda to go with the novelty song.
The novelty song? I think Freo's got that covered.
Yeah, you should watch the Freo one. I don't want to watch the Freo one. It's a strawny mark too.
Is Ross in it?
No. Oh, no, Nathan Fife is it?
No. I hate it. Anything else in the video? Eric Banner.
Eric might have been a close second to Staley. Staley is the second best thing.
I like how much of a cameo Eric Banner's role is.
Yeah.
He has so much to do all of the time, but he's in there for about 10 seconds saying 4 words and 3 of them are Ricardo.
I don't like their chances to win, I've got to be honest.
Well, apparently the Melbourne one's nice.
The Melbourne one just tugs the heartstrings straight away.
Yeah, but we did the song and we got Eric Banner.
Melbourne have the kids. Ah, the kid, sorry.
Is that it?
Yep.
Is that the year? Like, that was the year. That's how we saw the year. That was it, that. Yeah. Is there anything else you want to mention before we go?
Well, we're all just super psyched for the draft. So hopefully you can really wash away the clouds that are gathering over the club.
Well, I don't know. Two people made up those clouds. I don't know. Did they? Now I'm drinking from the Kool-Aid.
The Kool-Aid's been there all year.
It's been delicious.
I'm glad someone's got some enjoyment out of it.
All right. Thanks for listening. That was the 2013 season review podcast. Thanks for listening. That was the 2013 redwhiteandblack.com.au season review podcast. I've been Tom Brillier.
I've been Richard Lee.
And check out redwhiteandblack.com.au for more, or follow us on Twitter at RWBFooty. Thanks very much.
See you.